when I was in, like grade school, I got picked on for my weight, among other things. I got picked on for a lot of things. But my weight always came up. When people wanted to hurt my feelings, they would definitely bring up my weight. And I wasn't a fat kid at all. Not in the least. I had two older brothers who were definitely like thinner than me, I guess. But throughout my childhood and the high school years and until really my 20s, I was a thin person. But other people talked about me like I was fat. My family, my mom and dad and my brothers all called me Porky. And my middle brother, his nickname was Bones. The way it affected me was, you know, I knew that I was supposed to look a certain way. I knew I was supposed to be muscular and trim and handsome. Like these were the things that a guy was supposed to do, especially if he wanted to have a girlfriend. And so I desperately wanted to be the muscular type, the buff type. And the way that I thought you did that, based on montages and movies where people are getting into really good shape, I decided I was going to start drinking a glass of egg each morning, because that's what I had seen them do on TV. They'd crack an egg and work out and get buff. So the first morning I did it, and it was horrible, but I thought, this is what you have to do in order to get the body that is most desirable for me. And the second morning I got up and cracked myself an egg, poured it in the glass, and tipped it back, and the egg got about halfway down my esophagus before it came back up in a little yellow ball onto the counter that just kind of jiggled a little bit. And never again did I try the egg experiment, and I didn't get buff from it. And that just... It kind of felt like I was supposed to change my body. And I always, after that, I actually kind of just decided, you know, screw it. Everybody thinks I'm fat. Fine. I will just be fat. And I think that kind of backfired. You know, if people were trying to prevent me from getting fat, what it did was make me apathetic to the fact that I was fat. When people tell you you're fat all the time, you do one of two things. You either accept it and stop giving a shit, or you try desperately to change it. And what a lot of these programs like Strong4Life do or are hoping to do is to get kids to change, to want to change their body, which they believe is a positive thing. But as we know from studies of weight loss in kids and adults as well, it never results in the thing that you're looking for, which is permanent thinness. And instead, it leads kids to eating disorders and problems with food and all kinds of negative things that can impact their health and, in fact, cause and exacerbate the very things that they think they're trying to cure by shaming people into wanting to lose weight. And the other thing you can do is turn them apathetic, like me, where I believe that I was fat. There was nothing I could do about it. So what? How much worse could it get if I just enjoyed that extra mayo on my McChicken sandwich, you know? And for a long time, I didn't give a shit. And you know what? I didn't get fat until I was in my 20s, and I had a serious relationship catastrophe that sent me into a lot of stress. And I don't know if it's the combination of stress that did it, but that's when I started to gain weight. And you know what? Even then, I just didn't give a shit because I had already secured in my mind the identity that I was fat. So being a little fatter wasn't a big deal. And the thing that's really toxic about that is that you don't want people to be apathetic about their bodies. You don't want them to be apathetic about their health. You want them to have a vested interest in their health. What you want in a public health campaign is encouraging people to exercise, not discouraging them from being fat. And what that should be a minimum bar that we set for normal public health campaigns. And then you've got Strong4Life, which is an abnormal, cruel, heartless, soulless campaign driven by God only knows what. I mean, I don't know what the meeting looked like when these people got together and they're like, hey, I have an idea. Let's put a billboard with fat jokes and we'll just put it all over the state. And there was somebody was like, yeah, that's a good idea. I kind of like the idea. Was there not one guy that said, hey, that's a dick move and we shouldn't do that to kids? Clearly there's not. Wendy Brown, who has been very active on Strong4Life's Facebook page, asked on January 16th, what is the BMI of the adults running this campaign and how many of you have been / are fat? How many of you have faced what it is like to deal with the way society treats and portrays fat people? If this is their response. Wendy, as an organization, we are committed to helping our employees and their families get and stay healthy. An example of this are the pedometers many of our staff wear on their shoes during the day. We have accounted for 3.4 million steps. Is there not like one person that grew up as a fat kid that could have given them maybe a little perspective and said, hey, you know, I was a fat kid, and if I had seen those billboards, it would have made me shit my pants. Because I got to tell you, I was a fat kid. I wasn't even a fat kid. Like I said, I was barely chubby. And, you know, if I had seen those billboards, I would have been mortified. One of the routes to school went past a billboard. I mean, I can't imagine having to go past that billboard every single day and seeing that. Seeing the one that says, chubby kids may not outlive their parents. What? Where are we? There's another one that says something like stocky, chubby. They all mean fat. No, they don't. They don't, Strong4Life. There's this thing in the English language, in all languages, really, you know, when you break it down, called connotation. Connotation means the suggesting of a meaning by a word apart from the thing it explicitly names or describes. So although chubby technically is referring to somebody who has fat on their body, it's not the same as fat, and it's certainly not the same as obese. Unless we are fighting a chubby epidemic, I suggest you not tell chubby kids that they're going to die before their parents. That is a dick move. That is uncalled for. That is so inappropriate, I can't even begin to tell you. Are we going to start shifting all words that refer to excess body weight as obese? This organization that is staffed by people who took the Hippocratic Oath, people like Dr. Stephanie Walsh, who, in a response on ShareCare, the website ShareCare, somebody asked, how can I help my overweight child? And Dr. Walsh, okay, who's part of Children's Healthcare of Atlanta and is doing interviews defending Strong4Life's advertising campaign, she said, don't judge your child or make jokes about their weight. It is important that your child maintain a feeling of self-worth and increased self-esteem. That is true. That is 100% true. Dr. Stephanie Walsh, I applaud you for tackling this issue by first recognizing the stigma that is associated with obesity. And I applaud Internet Stephanie. Yay. And at the same time, I have to say, Dr. Stephanie Walsh, who is defending the Strong4Life campaign, fuck you! Fuck you! What the fuck? You say this, you tell other people, you advise other people, oh, don't make jokes about your child's weight. It's important that your child maintain self-esteem and self-worth. Don't drag them down. Be sensitive and tender. And then have billboards that say, big bones didn't make me this way, big meals did. Or, obesity prevention starts at home and the buffet. You know, you realize that thin kids go to buffets too, right? You realize that just because somebody is fat doesn't mean they go to the bath buffet every single day. But by putting these two things together on a billboard, you are sweeping all fat people up with a net and saying, here's your buffet, people. Congratulations, fatties. You are the buffet crowd. We love you. Go to the buffet, and we're going to point and laugh. Meanwhile, our thin kids can go to the same buffet and not experience a single sideways glance. Suri Cruz, K can walk down the street with an ice cream cone the size of her head. The ice cream could fall right off the cone and everybody would say, "Aww."
And she just got out of ice cream shop. She's like diving into it.
Aww. It fell.
He's so sweet in that ice cream cone. Oh, this childhood is wonderful. You see a fat guy with an ice cream cone and you say, "Again, what are they doing to that child? Why are they giving him ice cream? Fuck you. Just fuck you. Just do what you're supposed to do. Leave the kids alone. Bring down the billboards and end the advertisements. You've done enough damage. You've done 8 months worth of damage. And during that time, you've continued to say, "We are targeting parents. The kids don't see the messages because we gave their parents magic eyeglasses, which causes them to see the message of the billboard without the children being disturbed and their childhoods being crushed by our cruelty." On May 6, 2011, when this advertising campaign launched, Mr. Dr. Doofus Dickweed, Ron Friesen, he was on the Today Show, smiling uncomfortably as he explained how righteous they are to be doing this to fat kids. And in that clip, Meredith Vieira asks him this.
"And you're aiming it at parents. Is that correct? These particular ads is first time out."
"Well, actually, we want the parents to be aware, but we want educators to be aware, and we want other kids to see these kids who may very well relate."
From the very beginning, you stated unequivocally on the Today Show that this ad campaign is supposed to get the attention of parents, schools, and children. Children who look like the children in the billboards. It was your intention from the beginning. And now that you're getting called on it, you're saying, "Oh, we didn't target the kids. We just targeted the parents are the only ones that we're looking at. We're not judging anybody.
You are shameful fans."
It's really disturbing that in this age of eating disorders and self-harm and bullying and teen suicides that we would allow this campaign to go on for 8 months. That it would, that these billboards would be up in Georgia for 8 months and nobody would really say anything. And that they would get their publicity back in May and somehow, for some weird ass reason, they get more publicity in January for, like, not changing. Like, "We're still here being a bunch of assholes. Put me on TV. I'd like to tell people what a big asshole I am." That it's got to end, and it will end. We're going to end it. And in its place, we are putting up a billboard. We're going to be raising money for it. We need $10,000 to get this billboard put up in Georgia. Reagan Chastain of Dances with Fat, Marilyn One of Marilyn One, are both joining us in this fight. Roseanne Barr even threw out some support. Dan Savage is on board. This is going to stop. And we're going to stop it. And we're going to make sure it never happens again in any other state. I hope that this week, which begins National No Name Calling Week, that Children's Healthcare of Atlanta and Strong4Life will move on to phase two, which features happier things. The ads are in color. They had the ads back in May. They could have started phase two once they got all their attention and once the parents and children were alerted to the fact that they're horrible. Okay? You could have moved on by now, but you didn't. You didn't because you're getting plenty of attention, plenty of donations, plenty of volunteers whose misguided attempts at helping children is going to result in many more hurt children. So please, I'm begging you, stop. Leave the fat kids alone. And I would ask anyone who agrees with me to make a video explaining to Strong4Life what it's like to be a kid, a fat kid, who's bullied. We've got a writing campaign that we're organizing from fatkidsunited.wordpress.com. So please join us. Join us because every voice makes us louder.